Hello, my fellow coffee beans! I am back with a doll customizing video. It is going to be a longer video because not only am I doing a doll's face, but I'm doing their hair, I'm doing their clothing, and I'm putting together a whole bunch of goodies because this is part of a RetroDollsUS swap. I'm so excited. It's my first ever swap. It's a DECORA KEI swap. I believe it was Delightful, Mosekito, and somebody else. I can't remember who really made DECORA KEI stand out in the doll world last year with their dolls. I follow a DECORA KEI model on Instagram who is just so much fun to watch. And so I'm really excited to be a part of this swap, but I'm pretty sure I'm gonna do rainbow. I already bought some rainbow things for my girl. Okay, everything is falling. For her clothing, I bought rainbow buttons. I bought this rainbow polka dot fabric. Let me show you the dolls that I ordered. I ordered a couple dolls because I know I wanted my doll to have a big toothy grin, because the model that I follow, I can't remember her name. I suck. Anyway, she always has this huge toothy grin. She actually has braces, but I am not even going to attempt that on my dolls. So I ordered a Clawdia wolf, a courtly jester, and a kitty Cheshire. All right, guys, let's go get started. The first thing I'm going to work on for this doll is the hair. She's a hand-me-down from eBay, and as you can see, her factory hair has seen better days. It's all tangled and waxy from the glue inside her head. But one thing I do really like is the color. This yellow looks great with her skin tone. So it gave me a lot of inspiration for what colors I wanted to use for her hair. But before we get into that, let's get rid of this rat's nest. I start by cutting all the hair as close as I can to the scalp with good hair scissors. Some of my more recent doll makeovers have resulted in huge holes in the head from the factory hair plugs being too thick or too heavily glued. So I'm trying to avoid that with this one. After all the hair is cut off, I remove her head from her body by letting the vinyl soften in a cup of near boiling water. And please ignore my horrible purple fingers. I had just dyed my hair purple when I filmed this, and it got on my hands despite wearing gloves. Then, using some needle nose pliers and a pen casing, I scraped the inside of her head to remove all of that nasty glue and hair. Oddly enough, I absolutely hate the feeling of wet hair in my fingers. It literally makes me gag. But for some reason, doing this with the doll hair doesn't gross me out at all, and actually has the opposite effect. It's sort of soothing. Maybe it's subconsciously removing some tension for me? I don't know. Once all the glue is gone, I remove her face paint and her hair paint with some pure acetone. This is all super satisfying for me. To ensure I have a completely blank slate, I wash her head in warm soapy water. Now I can finally move on to rerooting her. I found these gorgeous colors on RetroDollsUS. I'll put a link to her awesome store below. I'm using a hank of Saran Hair in purple. I really like how this feels. It's a little waxy, but still soft, and I can already tell it's going to be really easy to separate into hair plugs, to make rerooting a lot quicker. The other hanks I ordered are all nylon. I got Lucky Green, Buttercup, and Hottest Pink. This nylon is amazing feeling. It's so soft and silky. I can't stop running my fingers through it. It's that kind of hair that, when on a Barbie, you just can't stop brushing or styling because you love touching it so much, you know what I mean? But even though it's so silky, it's surprisingly really easy to separate into plugs. I'm so happy with this hair that I got, and I'm really excited to work with it. Before I can start rerooting, I need to paint the scalp the same colors as the hair. So for the bangs, I'll be doing the Buttercup Yellow. The back of her head is going to be the Hottest Pink. This side by her right ear is going to be purple, and the opposite side by her left ear is going to be Lucky Green. And once that's all dry, I can start rerooting, finally! I know that this color is going to be used for the bangs, so I don't need the full length of the hank, so I can just cut it in half. Now, to actually reroot is super simple. You just grab your plug of hair, wrap it around your finger, and slide the hair onto your rerooting tool. Then, carefully and gently stab the tool into your doll's head. It sounds violent, but you really do want to be careful. If you literally just stab into it, you'll break your needle. I think working on this doll gave me the itch to have fantasy hair again. I used to have hot pink hair, but became allergic to the dye. But while working on this DECORA doll, it made me want it again, and I finally found something I could use. I had a lot of rerouting to do, so I hunkered down in front of my TV late at night, after both my toddler and husband were asleep, and separated and stabbed, separated and stabbed, separated and stabbed. I finished the yellow, moved on to green, which I forgot to film, and then purple. The hairstyle I had in mind has a lot of parts, the bangs, the purple and green, and the pink. So I needed to carefully separate the colors and plug them in strategically to create a smooth part that would still give coverage. So before starting the pink section, I separated the yellow, green, and purple sections, leaving a small space for the opposite color to fill in. This was really hard for me to demonstrate, so I made a little picture for you. For example, there's a part between green and pink. I can't just separate the green and pink because you'll see the scalp at the part line. Instead, I need to put some green plugs in the pink section and some pink plugs into the green section so that when I style the hair, the plugs will cover the scalp sort of like a weave. Jeez, I hope that made sense. I don't know why I had such a hard time explaining that. Anyway, once I had all the hair separated at the part, I continued to insert the rest of the pink hair. And when I was finally done, I brushed it out gently, careful to not accidentally pull out any of the plugs, and styled it into a loose braid. Then I poured in a very generous amount of Beacon's Fabri-Tac and pushed it around inside the head to make sure I covered all the plugs. Once this is dry, it'll help prevent the hair plugs from being pulled out when her hair is brushed or styled, and you can kinda see how much glue I poured in. While I'm waiting for the glue in her head to dry, which usually takes a couple of days for me, I'm going to get started on her clothes. I'm going to use this pattern from DG Requiem called Vintage Jumpers because I really like the suspenders look. And I can give it the DECORA aesthetic by adding some ruffles. I'll put a link to DG Requiem's store in my description. I highly recommend their patterns. They're really inexpensive and super easy to follow. The t-shirt is made out of blue cotton. The waistband of the dress is super cute rainbow polka dot cotton, and her skirt and all the ruffles will be this pink satin, rainbow heart cotton, green polka dot cotton, and this adorable cupcake cotton. The cupcake fabric will be the top of the skirt, so I'll use the dress pattern for that one. And the pink satin will be the lining, so I'll use the pattern for that too, but make it a little longer. The other fabrics are going to be ruffles to sort of act like a petticoat, so I'm going to cut those into long strips. To make the ruffles, I sewed a very wide and loose stitch along the top, then pulled on opposite sides to draw the fabric together, kind of like a drawstring on a hoodie. Then, when it was the length I wanted, I tied the two ends together and stitched it onto the pink satin. I hand-stitched a lot of this off-camera because the clothes are just too small for my machine, but here's the dress all stitched together. I added Velcro at the back along with some hook and eye closures. Our girl needs stockings too! Let's do some tie-dye. This is really easy to do with Sharpies and rubbing alcohol. I stretched some white stretchy fabric onto a cross-stitch loom, then made some random scribbles in Sharpie, and using an eyedropper, I dripped a few drops of rubbing alcohol onto the fabric and voila! The Sharpie bleeds just like tie-dye. I want to give her these tie-dye stockings, but I'm worried about the dye staining her legs, so I stitched a pair of regular white tights too. Then, using the same tights pattern, but minus the feet portion, I created little leg warmers from the tie-dye fabric. Now, this can be layered over the white tights to ensure the ink doesn't bleed onto her legs. Now that her clothes are all stitched together, I can finally start to add the little accessories and decorations. First, I added two cute buttons to the front of her shirt for some dimension, and I was worried that the buttons would be crooked or off-center, so it was easiest to sew these on while a dummy doll was wearing the dress, so I could find the center of the shirt. Next, I used pink embroidery floss to add little suspender-like straps to the dress. This was by far the hardest part, no joke, harder than sewing any of the clothes. I tied a knot at one end and then ran the floss through the fabric back to front, so the knot would be hidden. That was easy, but then sewing it to the back of the waistband from front to back and then trying to tie a knot without making the strap too loose or too tight was so hard. I'm sure there was an easier way to do this, and I was just having a dummy moment, but this took me several tries to get right. Then I took some light blue puffy paint and added a thin detail to the collar of the shirt, and to each button. Lastly, I took some pink puffy paint and added a thin line to the waist, and purple puffy paint to the bottom seam of the skirt. I decided to not add puffy paint to the other ruffles because I wanted the ruffles to look like a separate skirt, like a petticoat. Decora style is all about adding on any and all accessories you like, so I wanted the ruffles to look like a separate outfit accessory that she added on at the end. The purse was fun to make. I took the same metallic fabric that I used for the shoes and drew two circles onto it and cut those out. Then, using some pink ribbon, I stitched the circles, right sides facing each other, to the opposite edges of the ribbon. But I didn't sew the top of each side because that's the opening. I carefully stitched the open edges down to create a hem. Then I stitched this fun silver ribbon to the open edges of the pink ribbon as a strap and turned the whole thing right side out. And lastly, I added this adorable pizza sticker with some fabric glue.
I knew I wanted her shoes to be platforms, and luckily, the shoes that came with the Clawdia Wolf doll were kind of sort of like platform high heels anyway, so I thought the easiest thing to do would be to customize those by adding some fabric on top. First, what I did is cut off the little ankle straps, and I shaved the edges down a little bit with an X-Acto knife. I'm using this green fabric more of like a cast for the rest of the fabric to sit on top of. I think I'm going to leave just a little bit peeking out so it matches with her dress and her hair, but the whole shoe is not going to be green. So to start, I added a big glob of fabric glue all over the shoe, and then I pressed the fabric onto it. The fabric was kind of seeping out in the back, which worked out for me because I was able to push the edges together like a seam. I found the easiest way to attach the fabric to the shoe was by shoving the shoe onto the edge of a Sharpie. It was like the perfect width. Then I took the holographic fabric and glued the top edge down. Next, I turned it inside out and laid it across the shoe and sewed up the back seam. Then I flipped it inside out and slid it on top of the shoe. To create the platform effect, I took some thin craft foam and hot glued the edge around the bottom of the shoe. I squeezed in a lot of hot glue in the bottom of the shoe to add some stability to the structure. Then I cut it to the length I wanted. Once that's all dry, I can finally start to add the little details. I hot glued a plastic heart charm to the sides. That'll kind of help to identify which shoe is left and which is right. Then I added some lines and details with puffy paint. Then I repeated the whole process for the other shoe.
As much as I'd love to style her hair now, I need to do her face up first. I wrapped her hair in some spare fabric and secured it with some sewing pins. I use Mr. Super Clear to seal my face ups, but it's really sensitive to weather conditions. If it's too cold or too humid, it doesn't seal correctly, and it's difficult to draw on top of. Of course, when I was working on this doll, it was the middle of winter in the Pacific Northwest, so it was rainy and snowy and cloudy every day for weeks. But I finally had one sunny day, so I ran outside, sprayed her with MSC, and started on her face. I knew I wanted to use bright colors, so I started by applying white chalk pastels around her eyes and mouth. I cleaned up those little blobs with a kneaded eraser to get the shape that I wanted. Then I defined her eyes even more with a white watercolor pencil. Next, I outlined the shape of her eye with a light brown pencil similar to her skin tone. I decided it'd be a lot of fun to give her two different colored eyes. One is blue and the other is purple. I prefer to draw my dolls looking to the side. It can give them a mischievous or thoughtful expression, and I've noticed that when I draw my dolls looking straight on, they tend to go cross-eyed. It is a little tricky for me to get eyes even, so I'm constantly turning the doll in all different directions to see the symmetry better. When I was happy with her look, I went in with black watercolor pencil to finalize the eye shape. Black is hard to erase if you make a mistake, so it's always a final color for me. It kind of like seals the deal. I also added some red to the tip of her nose, cheeks, and chin to give her a more cheerful expression. Obviously, her smile is huge already, but I wanted her to look extra happy. I colored her lips with some hot pink pencil. I had to redo her eyebrows several times. I don't even think these are the final ones, but I wanted them to be small and sort of playful, rather than long and arched. That seemed too chic for me, and for how I imagined she'd look. I went back over all of my colors again to try and darken them and add definition, but in the end, I couldn't achieve the look I wanted, so I went in with some acrylic paint. Oh yes, there's her final eyebrows. They don't change much from here, I just tint them a light green to tie in her outfit and hair. Now it's time to paint her eyes. I added a thin line of white to her eyelids as well, so that I could add bright colors for the eyeshadow. I decided to do a fun yellow, green, and pink gradient. I added a light layer of colored pencil on top of the paint so I can sort of mark where I want the iris to go. Then I began to add the blue and purple acrylic paints to the eyes, starting with a mid-tone. I try to give my doll's eyes dimension by giving the iris multiple tones, rather than just one flat color. During this process, I'm also using a toothpick to add eyeliner, eyelashes, and the pupils. While the eyes are drying, I added a bit more pigment to the lips, along with a couple little shines. I really want to make sure those lips look nice and glossy. Finally, I went back in with my lightest shade in the eye colors and added them just below the pupil so that they really stand out. One of the most noteworthy things about DECORA KEI fashion are the stickers and decorations that they put on their cheeks. So, using white acrylic paint, I added a band-aid across her nose, small dots across her cheeks, and a heart and star near her eyes. While I had the white out, I added the much-needed eye shines to her eyes to make them really come alive. Next, I colored in the white dots, band-aid, and heart and star shapes with different neon-colored pencils, so she can have gorgeous rainbow stickers across her face. And finally, I took a dark gray pencil and added some definition to her teeth and eyes for some realistic dimension. Before I give her one final spray of MSC, I blushed her entire body with chalk pastels. I never used to do this, but I've noticed that it really gives dolls a realistic look rather than just a sculpted plastic doll. Why work so hard on making her face look real with gloss and makeup, but not add anything to her body? I also decided at the last minute to give her cute little undies. They're not perfect, but I thought it was still a cute and sort of funny touch. Her face is done, which means we can finally style her hair. Please ignore my messy kitchen island. Oh my gosh, it looks terrible. Off camera, I separated her hair into two high pigtails, and then braided everything tightly so that I can achieve some beautiful waves. I placed a rubber band around her head, level with her eyes, because that will be a really helpful marker for where to cut the bangs. This process is really simple, but dangerous. It's really easy to burn yourself, so be careful. To set the style, I poured boiling water over my doll, and then quickly dipped her into ice water. I repeated this a few times to really make sure the style was set. If you're planning on customizing a doll for the first time, make sure that your hair is heat resistant or heat safe before you do this method. I've heard of several doll artists who have spent hours rerooting only to have the hair melt after they style it, so be careful. Then I towel dried her hair and set her aside to dry completely. It's been several days and her hair is totally dry, so that means I can finally undo the braids. I want her to have a braided strand in front and the rest will be pulled back into a semi-pigtail space bun style. Ugh, confession time. I hate the term space bun. They're Odongo, they're Sailor Moon buns, or if you'd like, you can argue that they're Princess Leia buns. So, fashion people who don't know anything about Odongo or anime probably had a vague recollection of Star Wars or Sailor Moon from when they were growing up, and instead of looking up what the hairstyle is actually called, they just gave it a blanket term of space bun? Ugh! And I hate calling them that, but at the same time, I'm torn now because most people only know them as space buns. So the last thing I want to do is confuse people by calling them Odongo? Okay, sorry, rant over. The easiest way to make these bun pigtails was by pulling the hair up into a pigtail, wrapping a thinner strand around the rubber band, and then adding a second rubber band to hold that strand of hair in place. Plus, the hair is so thick that it was easy to hide the little piece of hair underneath. Then I repeated this for the green hair. I was really worried that this wasn't going to turn out, but I'm so happy with it. The height of the buns and the pigtails totally complement her little wolf ears. Then I removed all of the pink braids, very gently brushed them out, and began trimming her hair. Moving on to her bangs, The rubber band created the perfect guide for where I wanted to cut. I cut right across the dent and then trimmed as needed. When doing bangs, it's better to cut longer than you need and then trim as you go in layers. You can always make bangs shorter, but you can't make them longer once they're cut. I initially planned on her bangs being straight across, but her facial structure was just begging for this pointed fringe look. Next, we need to make her some adorable hairpins, another DECORA KEI must. I found these images online and printed them super tiny, before coating them in UV resin to give them a glossy, plasticky look and feel. Keep in mind, these images are not my own. If I were to sell this doll, I would have sketched my own images. I in no way want to claim ownership, let alone profit, from somebody else's art. But because these are for Nellie, as a part of a swap, I thought it'd be okay to use them, especially because they are crisp and easily recognizable. I chose these images based on my own likes, so I could pass on a little of my personality into this doll. So I did My Little Pony, Luna from Sailor Moon, Care Bears, and Molong. Unfortunately, Luna didn't make it into the final design, but everyone else is there. Then I carefully hot glued all of the pictures onto the ends of sewing pins and stuck the pins into my doll. I did this after watching Delightful's technique, but honestly, I wish I had just glued them straight to the hair. I think they would have been more sturdy that way.
After her hairpins are attached, I can add her eyelashes and give her glossy eyes and lips. These eyelashes are Ardell Professional Individual Eyelashes. I use the lightweight and short variety because they're a good size for dolls. They're a natural length for the human eye, but for doll eyes, they're just long enough to add some drama. I glued them on with a very thin layer of super glue. To really finish her face and give her some life, I painted on a thin, watered-down layer of DuraClear High Gloss Varnish onto her eyes and lips. I usually have to do 3 to 4 layers, with at least 30 minutes of drying time between each layer, in order to achieve the glossy look I like. She still needs some earrings, so I added these adorable glittery pom-poms to her ears with some fabric glue. The time has finally come. All that's left is to get her dressed. I made these two little necklaces off camera with some tiny beads and stretchy string. One is just random jewel tones, and the other is a rainbow with a heart in the middle. And the final touch, a mini manicure.
This is Kaori Tsume. I wanted to give her a Japanese name because, of course, she's DECORA KEI fashion, so I picture her living near Harajuku, and she goes there every night with her friends, and they dress up and they party and they take pictures with all of the neon and the other girls that are dressed up. So that's how I imagine she spends her nights. And this is her real hair, it's not a wig. I cannot stop looking at this gorgeous doll. I'm so proud of how she turned out. It's really exciting for me because she was my first doll that I made with you guys on my channel. She's my fifth doll. I think she's my fifth doll overall, either fifth or fourth. And you know, it's true what they say is you just get better the more that you practice and do something. And that's absolutely the case with her. I think she's the best doll I've ever done so far, and hopefully it's just gonna get better from here. I finally got matched up with my partner, which by the time I'm posting this, she should have already gotten her, so I really hope you like her. This is for Nellie, which is also known as Honey Peach Doll on Instagram. She also has her YouTube channel, Honey Peach Doll, so make sure you check it out. I'm gonna leave a link below. She has a lot of amazing dolls on her YouTube channel. So definitely inspirational, and I couldn't believe I was lucky enough to be able to send my girl to her. So that's just kind of surreal to me. Really, really cool. Plus, I didn't realize that Nellie lives in Sweden. So I'm sending Kaori here, all the way to Sweden. Man, she is taking quite a trip. I gotta pack her up really well.
Here's a quick glimpse of the box that I made for her. I was really worried about shipping her so far, so I was digging through all of my materials trying to find something she could travel safely in. And then it hit me. Why not ship her in her own doll box? As if she was straight off the toy store shelf. I used an abandoned Wild Hearts crew box and covered it in kawaii scrapbook paper. I even wrote her a little biography and glued her pictures on the back and the sides. I tied her into the back of the box with a needle and thread so that she could still have a cute pose, but still be secure.
My husband helped me a lot with her to give me ideas and some inspiration, so he chose her name Kaori. And then I decided on the name Tsume because it reminds me of Wolf's Rain, which is perfect because it's a Clawdia wolf doll, so what better than Tsume? And I believe in Japanese, Tsume means like claw or wolf. You'll have to let me know in the comments. I think it's claw. Before I ship her off, I just wanted to give some final thoughts. She's my favorite doll. I'm really sad to give her up, but really proud to give her up. She was a lot of hard work. I've been working on her since December, I think. And then the weather here in Washington, I live in the Pacific Northwest. The weather here has not been my friend. It has been rainy and cloudy and humid. And there was like one day, or maybe 2 days, like a month or so ago, that I was able to just run outside and spray her really quick with Mr. Super Clear while it was still sunny. Ugh. So she took a lot longer than I think my dolls normally take, just because of the weather was terrible. But we're starting to get into summer, so that means that I'll be able to do dolls a lot quicker. Knock on wood. Well, she's all finished and I'm really excited to send her off. I'm sad to see her go because I love her so much, but I'm so excited to gift her to Nelly. Nelly, you'll have to let me know what you think. I'm so happy to give her to you. I really hope you enjoy her just as much as I do.
Don't forget to click that like button and subscribe so you don't miss any future videos. Alright everybody, until next time, I'll see you on Monday. Love you a latte!